great. Now that we've recognized how easy it is to set down death, it should be just, you know, a ho-hum thing. It's no more difficult than anything else. We can take another step, right? And this next step came to my attention today. And it's very simple. I just say that no one is cut off from me. I don't cut off anyone from truth. So in other words, realizing the truth that all defenses are equally flimsy and have no real defensive ability whatsoever, and they're all can be set down gently and easily without any trouble whatsoever. Realizing this, there's no order of difficulty in miracles. What we then, with this understanding realization, we say, nobody is cut off. Nobody can cut themselves off from me. Okay, nobody can cut themselves off from the truth that I know about. No matter what they say or however they posture, I won't say that they're cut off from me. So if you refuse for anyone to be cut off from truth from your standpoint, then mind being one, you're not cut off from truth either. But as soon as you want to cut somebody off from truth, then you will feel that you too are being cut off from truth. So we're looking for the activation of this setting down death. Ultimately, the spiritual path really, unavoidably, is about setting down death, of course. Jesus said that's the last great barrier that we're all freaked out about. But you can't have a spiritual path without you having death as part of it and realizing you must dismiss death. So we certainly will do that. And we need to activate this. And the activation may very well be, the key activation key may very well be just saying, I'm not going to, nobody's cut off from the truth that I'm aware of. I don't care who it is or what they've done or what they said. Nobody can cut themselves off from truth, from God, from me, from the oneness. Nobody can cut themselves off from that. And so I've been just considering this, and it's just obvious, you know. It just seems like it's impossible. Doesn't matter what their agendas have been, whatever. They cannot cut themselves off from truth. It's impossible. And therefore, they can't cut themselves off from me. We can say that if we're going to accept truth. Nobody can cut themselves off from it. It's impossible. They're always on the right side of truth. So in other words, no matter who it is, if they come to you for advice, you give them the right advice. So in other words, there's not anybody that I would give the wrong advice to. This is the attitude one needs to have. There's not anyone ever that I would ever give the wrong advice to. And in this way, of course, you don't give yourself the wrong advice either. And if we make one exception, we too will feel that we're an exception. And we won't give ourselves the right advice. We won't allow ourselves to hear the right advice. So I would say this is the activating key to our ultimate success. Is that we would not ever cut off anybody from whoever comes to us for right advice. We will certainly advise them properly and say there's no order of difficulty in miracles. I mean, can you imagine if somebody comes to you and you tell them, oh yes, there's a very severe order of difficulties in miracles, and you have to go through all of this and this, this, this. No, having realized the truth, you're not going to lie to anybody. It doesn't matter if they were the great arch villain of the world and they have done so much terrible things and everything. If they come to you for right advice, you'll tell them, look, there is no order of difficulty in miracles. Absolutely not. So in other words, you're not going to intentionally or mislead anyone, give them wrong advice. You're going to give them the straight truth. Everyone who comes, and no exceptions. This overrides everything else. Everything is the most important, and for me, I certainly feel that way. I don't feel any difficulty with that whatsoever. Even the people who are leading the world astray, I would tell them correctly. Wouldn't even have to think about it. No, you share the truth, and it's up to them, you know, what to make of it. But you're sure not going to be the reason why they can blame you, saying, "Oh, you didn't tell me the truth." Or, no, you tell them the truth. So this should be the key that activates our realization, our setting down all problems as one. There's only one intensity of problems at all. That's completely flat, actually. How difficult is it to set something down that's completely flat? That's already resting on the ground. We just relax our grip upon it, is all we have to do. It's already set down. So all we need to do is relax our grip upon deception. And we only have deception because we're trying to give it to someone else. We can only give what we have. So if we're giving truth to others, that proves that we have it. We also have it. You can't give it unless you have it. Same with deception. If we're giving deception to others, that means that we are deceived also. It's very simple, very easy. We're getting ready for some rain here in California. Yeah, maybe we're going to get a half inch. Wow, you know, it's like, oh my gosh, what's happening? Half inch of rain? Oh, but then it's going to clear up quickly and the hot, dry weather returns. This is our extent of rain, just a little minor little bit, just to remind us that it's still possible. Jesus says, "What to give is to receive. To give is to receive." This is what he says. This is how it all works, because you cannot give something. In the giving of it, you prove that you have it. You're extending it. This is with ideas. To give is to receive. You can't receive it without giving it, because the giving is the final act, is the final completion of the truth that you have it. In order to give it. Now, with material things, that's confusing with us. But in terms of ideas, it shouldn't be confusing at all. To give an idea away, to give this idea, means that you have that idea. And of course, ideas, in giving, extending them, you don't lose the idea. The ideas can become stronger by giving them away. To give is to receive. So, be willing to share the truth with anyone, no matter who, what their past may seem to be, and no matter what your past may seem to be, you are giving permission for you to receive the truth as well. So this is likely the all-purpose key that keys everything else is to give is to receive. We tend to view like a cloudy day like this as an anomaly now, as I'm feeling like, don't worry, tomorrow will be fine. This is just some sort of weird anomaly. Don't even pay any attention to it. This is the problem. When you get really used to something like self-delusion, you think that truth is an anomaly. It's easy to dismiss situations as, oh, that's just an anomaly. No need to pay any attention to it. This is the danger, and this is what we've gotten to. Hummingbird just showed up, bird of paradise. Showed up, what time is it? I don't know. 6:20 something, but drinking. just hovering, floating perfectly. Taking a long drink. Wow. Still drinking. Okay. Right closer now into another flower. Knows exactly where to stick its beak to get the nectar. It's just right up here, about 3-4 feet away from me. On left here. Oh, still there. Still there. Now it just took off. Okay. Wow, that's a very long visit from a hummingbird. Seems like every video we do, we get a visit from a hummingbird now, drinking nectar. Quite amazing. Give and you shall receive. Give and you shall receive. So, to say that you will not cut off anyone from truth, and you won't cut yourself off either. If we feel cut off from truth, it must be because we are willing to cut others off from truth. You know, someone of another, you know, political party or social agenda, different sides of issues. Just feel like neutral in terms of whoever comes to you for truth, you will certainly share it with them. Doesn't matter what side of the aisle they are on. Because truth is just too valuable to just cast away. So, by all means, share the truth. I've been trying to share more during the day, going around. I just seem to trying to be a little more outspoken, if it's possible. Just feeling like, no, it doesn't matter what anyone's politics are, what their social, what their agendas are. Everybody comes to, has to come to truth. And so why should you stand in their way? If they want to come to truth, they have to, no matter what they think they've done or whatever they believe. They have to set down the false belief system, which is the belief that reality has a flaw or flaws, and they have to recognize that reality is perfect. There's no choice. So you might as well tell them straight up the truth. This storm is bringing a little bit of a chill to the air. So again, we have the key that we need to give. Is to receive. To give is to receive. To give is to receive. To give is to receive, full stop in the wow. So if you're certain, I say, I would not cut off anyone for any reason from truth. I would not have anyone separate from truth. Okay, this is your statement. I would not have anyone separate from truth, no matter what you think they've done to you or will do to you, no matter how crazy their ideologies are or politics are. You wouldn't cut them off. And if this is something that you know, and you have a shirt that confirms this, it is true that sometimes you feel that you're getting cut off and to blame others for that. But I would say that you feeling cut off from truth is because you want to cut others away from truth. You want someone to suffer. You want someone to be ignorant of truth. You want someone to pay some sort of penalty. We need to keep working to the point where we can say, I don't wish ignorance of truth upon anyone for any reason. Of course, if they're ignorant of truth, they're going to keep on misbehaving. So that doesn't serve any purpose to refuse. You know, it doesn't serve any purpose to cut anyone off from truth. Just get worse and cause you more troubles. So be absolutely willing in your mind to share the truth with any and all right now. This is a tough one. This is a very tough one. Wow. It's trying to hit me asleep and trying to drag the consciousness into unconsciousness about this. To give is to receive. To just be aware, yes, I already know that there's no one I would ever cut off from truth. Yes, I already know there is no one that I would see separate from truth. Yes, I already know that there is no one that I would see separate from truth. Okay. Yes, I already know there is no one I would see separate from truth. Yes, I already know that there is no one I would cut off from truth. And what has just happened here? Wow. Interesting. The whole video went blank and flashed. And yes, I already know there is no one I would cut off from truth. Yes, I already know that there that I, there is no one that I would see separate from the truth. I already know there's no situation I would see separate from the truth. I already know there's no spirit I would see separate from the truth. There's no one I would ever see separate from the truth. I already know there's absolutely no one that I would ever see separate from the truth. So we found another powerful assertion, which is what we look for. It's what we look for. These assertions are like, you know, shorthand, powerful shorthand that clue us into that they're really the keys that unlock the prison doors. To use metaphorical poetic language, so yes, I already know that there's absolutely no one that I would ever see separate from the truth. There's absolutely nowhere that I would ever see separate from the truth. Yes, I already know there's absolutely nowhere that I would ever see separate from the truth. Now, this pertains more to our environment, and I would never deny any area, any place, the advice of truth either. I would never see it separate from truth. So whatever place, whatever person, whatever thing comes to me, I would always give it truth. So with this attitude, this is a be attitude, an attitude that leads to being, an attitude that opens the door to being, a be attitude. Now, of course, you recognize this is how you feel, what need of judgment do we have? Because we're not judging between, okay, well, this person I'm not going to advise truthfully, and this other one I will, and how to discern between them. There's no need for any of that. There's no need for that. Everybody, when they want right advice, if they ask, certainly, well, tell them the truth, share the truth with them. And every place, I certainly do not withhold the awareness of truth from any place whatsoever. I do not withhold the awareness of truth from any place or anyone, ever. So I guess I already know that I do not withhold the awareness of truth from anyone or on any place ever. Even in the midst of some battle, some contest, in some conflict, if someone would ask you, you know, can you tell me the truth? What is the truth? Sure, absolutely. You know, this is the truth. I would not hold it apart from anyone under any circumstance or condition. So how can I hold myself apart from it based on any circumstance or, you know, condition? Cannot either, right? So since I'm part of the everyone, you know, there are the no one. There's no one I would, you know, withhold the truth from. So I'm part of that statement also. That's such an all-inclusive statement that we include ourselves in that too. It is getting it's getting more chilly, and it's actually going to snow down to, I think, 4,000 feet. So there might even be some snow in the mountains around. That's the coldest we've had for years, actually. I don't think, yeah, it's going to be it was rather cold. There was actually frost last night. It's amazing. It was like, I got down to 39 or something frost. And so this is a cold front that is coming through. We haven't had a cold front in a long time. What is it? Jeez, it's Monday, isn't it? I'm tired for a Monday, but worked really hard this weekend. And these videos, certainly, we have to try and not go to sleep on them. So by not withholding truth from anyone, we don't withhold it from ourselves. By not withholding truth from any place, we don't withhold it from the place we're at right now. So this should work. All teachings indicate that this attitude, be attitude, works. This is a be attitude, an attitude of being. This is how we awake to our beingness, to the beingness of everywhere and everyone, by not withholding it from anyone or any place. So even the most irritating of people, if they came to you and asked, you know, they wanted to know what they could do to know truth, then you would, you know, tell them truly. Say, don't exclude anyone from truth, and you yourself will have it yourself, you see. Certainly, you'd tell them. I can't think of anyone or any place where I would, you know, actually want to withhold truth from anyone under any circumstance, should they, that be, you know, what they want. So I'm not going to be the author of denial of truth, I'm not going to deny truth to anyone, I'm not going to be part of that, or deny truth to any place, anywhere, any when, any time, any when. Not going to deny truth to right now. Why should I deny the awareness of truth to right now? Why? Is there any moment that I would want to deny truth to? No. So, yes, I already know that there is absolutely no moment that I would deny truth to. No moment, no any, nor any place, nor any person that I would deny truth to. Because truth can only bless, and so why would we withhold a blessing from anyone? The very ones that we see as our enemies are the ones who need the blessing the most. So why withholding it from them only perpetuates, you know, the feeling that they're our enemy. I certainly don't want enemies. So absolutely let them be blessed. Do not withhold any blessing from anyone or anywhere or any win. Yes, I already know that I do not withhold any blessing from anywhere, any win, or anyone. Yes, I already know that I do not withhold the blessings of truth from anyone, from anywhere, or any win. So in spite of the severe fatigue I'm feeling now, we're soldiering through this and getting it out there. Now, it's true I didn't get hardly any sleep last night. everything remains very intense. Uh, whatever it is that the world is rushing towards, it's rushing there very intensely, as I pointed out in this, the foreshadowing of these times, this whole pizza, piazza, dream I had, where something very something very messy is going to happen, and I actually had to leave the area. I tried to cleaned up some of it, but I had to leave the area, go to a rest room, a place of rest, And the people there that were in this pizza parlor were like, oh my gosh, and what's going on? So this has to do with the discovery of Ceres and arriving at Ceres, the dwarf planet Ceres. So everything's in play right now. We're in the apocalypse, and we're rushing towards the, you know, final act of that. It's time. The clock is ticking on us. So we most certainly have to do everything we can to find the keys. And so this is what I'm giving out here, is extremely important some extremely important keys. And you can see that we've been taught to fall asleep when we try to think this way. And as that fatigue hits us, we tend to turn our attention somewhere else to not be so sleepy. So this terrible sleepiness can come across upon us, a fatigue, when we're getting close to truth. And you have to just keep fighting through it. So I guess I already know that that I would not withhold blessings from anyone, anywhere, any when. So that means my blessings rest upon all right now. And since my blessings rest upon all right now, I therefore would see a completely blessed world. And if everything is blessed, how can I not be blessed by that? Give and ye shall receive. This is another one of Jesus' main teachings that he reinforces all the time. If we believe it's possible to keep the truth from someone, but we believe it's possible to keep the truth from us then, and we build a defensive system, we're frightened. Two-thirds of California is now labeled what? Catastrophic drought. Not just severe drought, catastrophic drought. Now, when we're talking about I would not withhold blessings from anyone, the blessings of truth. It's not that I would do anything for anyone necessarily. I mean, we're talking about spiritually truth, telling them the truth. We have a bunch of home invasions taking place now. That's the first around this area, and it's people coming over from the other side of the valley, coming in and ransacking your home for jewelry, and it's an epidemic here. So I don't want them doing that, you know, here or anywhere here. Actually, people are getting very jittery and fearful. But if they came to me for truth, I would certainly share the truth with them. Came for blessing, certainly share a blessing. I wouldn't encourage them to continue with such endeavors, you know. But I would certainly not withhold any, you know, blessing of truth from them, because that would only help them. Truth only blesses. The police have been cut so badly in neighboring cities that they only respond to life-threatening situations. So they get a call for a home invasion, a robbery, and someone ransack my house. They just shrug, you know, and say, well, you know, you don't really have the manpower to send anyone out there. So, of course, the robbers, the thieves, are becoming extremely emboldened now. They feel like they're immune. You know, the police don't even respond. And so you want to the question, does civilization tend towards anarchy? Absolutely it does. If you don't keep up the standards of civilization, absolutely it tends towards anarchy. And we're living proof of that now. I mean, this area has been bulletproof for a long time. No longer. Broad daylight. As soon as the mother walks her children to school, they get in the windows, they get in the house and ransack the place. She comes back and they're actually still in the house, you know, so that they're just waiting until you leave for work, until your house is empty, and they just go right on in. That's how bold they are right now. And this is spreading throughout the area. People are installing all video systems and, you know, alarms and everything. It's very bad. So we used to never worry about closing your windows or locking your doors or anything like that. Never even, you know, for a long time, we never even crossed our minds. Maybe if we go on a vacation or be gone all day, but even that, you know, you never even thought about it. People were so honorable. And now, you know, this is extremely dishonorable activity that's taking place. Of course, if you are willing to give blessings to everyone, you're extending all blessings to yourself as well. So what can happen to you? Nothing bad can happen to you. If you're willing to give nothing but goodness to all, you know, I wish perfection upon all. So how can I be immune from such perfection? I wish invulnerability to everyone. So I certainly wish it upon myself. I wish absolute prosperity upon everyone. So I certainly wish that upon myself. I grant that to all. And you may think, oh, you're granting invulnerability to criminals? Oh, yes, but I'm also granting it to you and everyone else, so they can't touch you at all. You see? Where are there criminals when everybody has everything and nobody can lose anything? How could there be criminals then? You know, how can there be terrible people when nobody can harm you in the slightest bit? For instance, a murderer, you would give them the blessing of, you know, total invulnerability. You wouldn't exempt them from that, okay? Because in extending it to everyone, how can they kill anyone? How can any, right? It's impossible. That would be impossible. So how could they be a murderer? You see, that's right. It's impossible. And so, only when you want to cut somebody else off from invulnerability do you become so believe that you're vulnerable. That's how it works. This is how Jesus tells us, this is how it works. There's no reason to doubt, in spite of all the strange so-called teachings about Jesus that you hear in a lot of places. Don't be dismayed by them. If you like the church, if you like the ritual, if you like everything, okay, that's fine. But do not be deceived by any of the teachings or be dismayed by any of those teachings. There is a real set of teachings from Jesus, and this is what we're getting here. And give and ye shall receive. Absolutely. Whatever you give, you shall receive. If you give vulnerability to death to others, that's what you shall receive yourself. If you give invulnerability to everyone, that is what you shall receive. You shall be of that mind, which sees no difference anywhere, that realizes all has all, and so you recognize your oneness with this truth. So, be willing to extend truth to everyone, and you will have extended it to yourself as well. There's no limit to the extension, so you cannot keep yourself out of it at all. It's unlimited extension. Willing to give truth, to extend truth to all, to all, to the allness, forever. Well, you're not separate from that at all, right? So you're completely within the field of your own blessing. So be willing to extend truth in all directions forever. And you will never walk without it. So at least we're hearing this, and this is a very important step. Gradually this sinks in. I feel untroubled by it at this point. I'm not troubled by it. But don't struggle with it. Just stay in the wow. If you start thinking, oh, wait a minute, what about this? What about then? You're missing the wow of it. You're not full stopping in the wow. Obviously, this sort of this information is just fantastic, incredibly relevant. You can say, wow, if this is true, just as I feel maybe this is true, wow, I'm seeing it could very well be true. This is like of utmost importance. So focus on that, the success that you're having, instead of trying to find some concern or worry or objection. Don't try to find any objection or worry or concern to it, because it's way more likely that you're concerned about that it's true, and you're concerned about the success that you're going to feel. You know, you're going to feel everything is blessed, and you're saying, well, I'm not used to that. I'm used to thinking that some things are separate and, you know, judgmental. I'm used to being judgmental of, okay, this one gets a little bit of blessing, this one a little bit more, this one a little bit more, and then but now you're ready to enter into realize everyone gets to all blessing. You know, I'm not holding back any blessing from anyone or anywhere or any win. So when you're willing to give total blessing to everywhere, when and what, when and where, everyone, when and where, total blessing without holding anything back, you yourself will then experience the total blessing. It might be an advantage to be in a cosmopolitan area where you see every kind of person. You know, it's conceivable that there's an advantage to that. I mean, you have to look for some silver lining. Here in the Bay Area, we are just you rub elbows with people from, you know, every culture in the world, basically. And, you know, in spite of all the frustrations and the terrible driving we're getting from people who just, I mean, I ran into another situation. It's so dangerous. Somebody is looking for an address and they're getting ready to turn. It's pretty a fast road. And they say, okay, this is it. And they start to turn. And in mid-turn, I'm right behind them. I say, okay, I just keep going. They're turning. In mid-turn, they decide, wait a minute. Maybe this isn't it. And they start to try to push back in traffic. And I'm right there. I'm passing them. And so I just have to hit the accelerator as fast as I can to get around them. You can't drive that way. You can't like be making a turn onto another road and then mid-turn you're already off, you're out of your lane and turning, and then suddenly, whoops, let me just go right back into traffic and there's a car there, you know? It's just like, wow, crazy driving here. And of course, there's by people who are new to this area and new to this country, actually. There's just a ton of immigrants here from all over the world that they bring in for technology jobs. And they're driving all over the place, and they don't know where they're going, so they're very distracted, and you never know what they're going to do. You never know what, you're not sure what any driver is going to do here. Prepare for, just expect the unexpected, and you need to be real patient. And when I saw them turning, I said, you know, are they committed? You know, I wasn't sure they were committed then, and right away I said, hey, maybe they're not committed. Uh-oh. And you get caught in no man's land. So had to, you know, either you slow down and just wait, or you accelerate. It's probably better just to slow down and wait, because try to play it safe. Well, either that or get a Ferrari or a Aston Martin or something. And so you just have, you know, instant acceleration there. That's actually not a bad thing to have. Where the acceleration, there's no lag. What my vehicle, you floor it, and there's the engine revs, and then it goes. There's a lag there. You know, it's not instantaneous. You really actually, to be safe here, you need a car where the acceleration is just super swift, and also the braking super swift. It's really a necessity here. Listening, God, I do not withhold the blessings of a Ferrari from anyone. Let everyone here have a super nice new car, because that would actually help everybody be safe. Absolutely. Yeah, I would not withhold it for myself either. It would help make it safer. Because there's a lot of dicey situations now that arise, and you have to decide, shall I brake or shall I accelerate? Just real quick, you have to make a real quick determination. When I was young, I had a stick shift sports car, and that thing accelerated, just snapped your head back, and you know, I could just get out of any tight situation just super, super fast, and that actually was very, very helpful. You get people slowing down on a freeway. I mean, I've had people stop on the freeway, basically. Yeah. They say, wait a minute, did I miss the exit? I'm not sure. And they just slow down and down to like, you know, 5 miles an hour right on the freeway. And then finally, after they stopped on the freeway, basically, then they get off on the shoulder. And I'm like right behind them. So, oh my gosh. This is these people are not from this place area. That is for sure. You cannot do. I see every day driving that I've never seen before. It's just so. The world is changing. This area is extremely cosmopolitan. There are immigrants streaming into here constantly, even though there's no water. And the population of California has doubled in not very long time. But I think that someone said there's like 40 million people here now. So blessings. I hope that everybody has water. I mean, I would not withhold water from anyone, anywhere, ever. You know, the necessities of life. Give all to all, and you shall have all. Give all to all, and you yourself shall have all. And if you have all, why would you worry about what others have? They can't deprive you of anything. So how could they be your enemy? And if they're not your enemy, why would you deprive them of anything? This is the reasoning behind the whole situation. and don't dwell on what you feel are exceptions and tough situations, because obviously that undermines your momentum. If you determine that this teaching is true, then the worst thing to do is try to undermine it. So when you go full stop in the wow, when you recognize, hey, wow, this is it, then just stop in the wow. Don't try to bring up any negative situations that might bust the momentum up. That's very harmful. Focus on the righteousness of it, the truth of it, and be just neutral. Don't struggle. Don't try to push anything anywhere. But certainly, keep your mind steady, and not evaluating anymore, because you've already evaluated. You've already seen. Oh wow, this is true. And then, so don't doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. As your mind sort of get a little tired, it slips down into the dark a little bit. Don't get all paranoid and panicky and start thinking about exceptions. Well, what about this? Well, what about this situation? Now, that's what we're avoiding here. That's what we want to avoid. This is what ruins your momentum. So you have to go in faith. This is what Jesus has told us. I have faith that Jesus has told us correctly. So I'm also seeing it to a certain extent clearly, and I say, okay, I see that this must be so, must be true. So I have faith in it, and I say, I absolutely believe this is true. So I'm sharing it. And so when you get this feeling, oh, this is true, then don't doubt it. Don't get into any doubt mode. Watch your mind, full stop, and then wow. No doubt mode. Well, wow is a part elation, part what's the word? Trepidation. Yeah, elation and trepidation. The trepidation is a continuity fear. It's not doubting. It's saying, whoa, I know this is true. What's going to happen when I, you know, get all blessings for myself because I've been willing to extend it to everyone else? What's going to happen, you know? It's like that. So it's part elation, part trepidation. And then just stay with that, the elation and the trepidation, but not the doubt. Don't indulge the doubt. Do not indulge the doubt. I don't care what the situation is. Because there's always going to be something you can bring up that seems to be some real tougher than other stuff. But why, if you believe that this is true, why then focus on something that's real tough for you right now? Why not get used to the truth first, and then later on you'll be able to dispel this rough spot? You know, when you're practicing, it's no place to try to bring up these rough spots. You're trying to gain momentum and faith and momentum and poise and familiarity. So you're working on familiarity and expectation here, not on trying to answer some real tough situation that you feel is confounding you. Working on familiarity and expectation, getting familiar with the truth and high expectations, getting familiar with elation about, wow, I really am going to be totally blessed here, you know. Getting used to that. This is practice. This is practice. So practice requires discipline. Do not allow those negative scenarios to enter your mind when you're practicing. There's plenty of time for that when you're not practicing. In other words, don't try to bring up the worst possible scenario you can think of to confound the truth that you know is true, that you're focused on trying to get used to it. How can you get familiar with truth if you're bringing up something to try and confound it? That's working at cross purposes. So do not search your mind for what is a supremely confounding situation. Because I've seen that the more confidence you get in truth and the more relaxed and comfortable you get with truth, the easier it is then to extend it to all. Okay, the only problem we're having is we're not extending everything to everyone. That's the trouble. So it's not anyone out there that is causing us a problem. It's our own unwillingness to extend it to everyone without exception. So it's our only trouble comes when we make an exception, trying to cut somebody else off in some way, then we ourselves feel cut off in the exact same way. Give and you shall receive. So don't go searching for exceptions or confoundments. That doesn't exist, actually. Just reinforce your familiarity and comfort and expectations with this good news, with the gospel of give and you shall receive. How are we doing here on this video? Doing okay. Well, now, opening day, opening night, baseball season, I said, well, am I going to watch it? And I said, well, I might or I might not, it depends. I'm certainly going to tape first, though. And first business here. This is way more important than anything else. But if I get business taken care of, then I'll probably go in and watch. Some of it. We'll see. But first, take care of business here. And this is what we're doing. This has been a very good video. Better than I expected, feeling so tired and not sure how I would do. Give and you shall receive. Just introduce this, start getting used to it. Whatever we're experiencing is what we want others to experience, or at least what we want at least someone to experience. We're making an exception to perfection for someone, then we're going to experience that exception from perfection ourselves. So if we want someone to die, if we make an exception to perfection and believe that someone can die, then we ourselves then will experience that same belief, that we believe that we will die. So actually, all is perfect right now. But we're simply believing in exceptions to that perfection. And that is then seemingly cutting ourselves off. At least we're having this dream of being cut off ourselves. Give for everyone freedom from the belief that they're a body. Don't hold anyone to a body at all. And you're not, then you won't hold yourself to a body either. Don't hold anyone to the feelings of the flesh, and you will not be held to the feelings of the flesh either. Do not make any exceptions there. It's very important. Do not hold anyone to the attractions of the flesh. In other words, don't insist that someone be bound to be an attractive body, attractive flesh, because then you yourself will feel bound to flesh. Okay. So do not demand anyone, free anyone from, you have no demands that anyone appear as an attractive form of flesh at all. And you yourself will not feel bound to appear as flesh, attractive flesh either, or even a flesh at all. Do not bind anyone, insist that someone has to be some sort of successful body, somebody. And you yourself then will not be bound to trying to be somebody, some successful body. And you will give the blessing to all. I am spirit, I am free, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. let that be the realization for all, that I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And then certainly then that will be the blessing that you experience as well. So give up the idea of specialness, that there's some special person. You demand that there be some special person. Well, that demand that someone be cut off from perfection, then you will experience the same demand that you be cut off from perfection. In perfection, there's no special persons or special, you know, there are no bodies and no special persons. There's everyone has everything, actually. So these are Jesus' teachings, and so we're getting used to this. It's very beneficial. Just hearing it, familiarity, expectation, continuity, fear, dealing with all of that, it's evaporating. So for sure we will have all, because we'll be willing to give all to everyone. It's that simple. We just can't make an exceptions. Can't make an exception. That's the whole key to it. Ah, well, the baseball season's already started and I missed it. And that's great. See, that's okay. That's all right. Because this is more important. This is more important. It's go time. This is it. This is it. We're really, this situation, the world, this is really it. This is it. And so we need these keys for our own welfare. If we want to be happy, extend happiness to everyone. Do not, in other words, don't insist that someone be deprived of it. If we want wealth, don't insist that anyone be deprived of it for any reason. If you want, invulnerability, don't insist that anyone be vulnerable for any reason. You know, in other words, grant perfection to all. Without exception, to everyone, to everywhere, to every win. So there's quite a buzz on this one. We're able to get into this here and assert it. Yes, I make assertions. Yes, I already know. That type of assertion. So this is very, very powerful teaching and practice here. Just getting familiar with this and our getting our expectations in this direction is very, very powerful. Life-changing. You know, don't demand that anyone be a body for any reason whatsoever. And you will not demand that you be a body for any reason whatsoever. How about that? Yes, I already know that I'm not demanding that anyone be a body for any, under any circumstance. I grant, you know, freedom from bodies to everyone in perpetuity. Never do I have a demand that anyone ever be a body. And then we receive that same freedom also. Give and ye shall receive, give and ye shall receive, give and ye shall receive. So obviously, if someone is not teaching this, you want to stay away from that, right? Because this is a fundamental truth. So we have to hear this and we have to apply it if we want, you know, to be happy, to be safe, to have peace of mind. So I grant absolute, I don't ask for any lack of freedom to anyone, ever, in any circumstance. Everyone has perfect freedom in all circumstances. Therefore, I do too, and then therefore there aren't any circumstances, are there? So I do not demand that there ever be circumstances for anyone. How about that? Yes, I already know that I do not demand that there ever be circumstances for anyone. Yes, I already know that I do not demand there ever be situations for anyone. And then this is tacitly not demanding that there ever be any lack of freedom for anyone. If there's no circumstances or situation, then there must be perfect freedom, right? So I absolutely do not demand that there ever be circumstances or situations for anyone. I allow perfect freedom from all circumstances and situations to everyone without any exception. Now, I was going to go down to the market and get all sorts of chips and dip and desserts and have a big opening day party, but I said, you know, this is more important here. You got to lead, have to lead by example. And for me, opening day of the baseball season is the most important day of the year. It's without anything, even nothing's even close. I've waited 5 months for this day. I mean, 6 months of baseball. April, May, June, July, August, September. If you're a Giant fan, you get 7 months of baseball because they're in the playoffs, going to the World Series. So we're looking forward to 7 months of baseball. So that's the best day of the year, but I decided no. You know, this is more important. This actually makes it the best day of the year by being able to share the truth, the core teachings of Jesus. That makes it the best day of the year. This is called having right priorities. Right priorities. So it's already a 7:20. So the game is already underway. And I don't have any chips or anything special. Have to do this taping first. Can't afford to lose a day. Absolutely not. We have to discover the secrets of truth right now, don't we? Because artificial intelligence is never going to tell us that. And artificial intelligence is taking over the world. Most people in the world are like zombies already. And when you're around zombies, you tend to become like them. That's why I say, God, just put me out on some golf course somewhere where there isn't anybody around. And I don't want to hang around zombies. And again, it doesn't mean, remember, I'm not asking that I'm not demanding that anyone be a zombie. I grant absolute freedom from all circumstances and situations to everyone forever, without any exception. But they may be trying to, you know, make exceptions for others, and so they're experiencing it being a zombie themselves. So I certainly don't want to hang around those who are zombies, because then you tend to become like that. It's where do you find someone who's willing to profess the truth, in conversation every day? It should be everyday conversation. What's the big deal? What are we so uptight about? Well, artificial intelligence has made us so uptight. Say it's not fair. You're trying to be smarter than me. You know, trying to be? No, I'm not trying. I am smarter. Actually, in pursuing artificial intelligence, we're trying to be dumber than what we are. So why are we doing that? It's ridiculous. So, It's the zombie apocalypse. The curtain is being raised, and we're saying, oh my gosh, everybody's been turned into a zombie. It's true. Meaning they are being, they believe their life is, artificial intelligence is their life. They can't live without it. This is what they are. If they want to know themselves, all they have to do is Google it and look at whatever answer they want. They can find any, you know, whatever they're, however they want to see themselves, Google will provide links. But Google can't get out of its own way. Artificial intelligence can't get out of its own way. We can get out of our own way, you see. Because we're inherently not in the way of anything. And we can realize this. Artificial intelligence can't realize that everything's perfect. There's no capacity for any of that. Full stop in the wow here. We're practicing that now. Full stop in the wow. We're not searching for some exception to truth. That's the ego that searches for exceptions to truth and then tells you, hey, what about this exception? Yeah. We're not doing that here. We're building momentum here. We're building familiarity here. So don't pay any attention to anything the ego says. Don't even bother listening to it. Full stop in the wow. And don't let the mind drift off into pleasant scenarios, because what the ego will do once you're in that pleasant scenario, then it will suddenly flip the script on you and start bringing up objections. So it's very important when you full stop in the wow, don't let your mind be led off anywhere. Even in pleasant directions or innocuous directions, or say, oh, that's no big deal. No, the ego is intentionally doing that. The ego can't wait to bring up exceptions. Say, wait a minute, you know. You really mean this? You know, that's why spiritual truth has to be practiced in a format of practice, because when you get in dialogues with people, you don't get any momentum because it's expected. You say, wait a minute, what about this severe exception, you know? And you'll battle back and forth, and you're not allowing your familiarity and expectations and continuity fear to gently settle in and evaporate, you know, the continuity fear to evaporate. You're not allowing that to happen. You're not really making progress. So in practice, you keep all the objections out. The ego is, we have the, when you're practicing, we're the ones who have the floor. You know, the council that's asserting that truth is true and nothing else is true, they're having their time to speak. And the ego, it has to be quiet. It cannot keep raising objections. This is like final summation. You cannot raise objections. You know, you can say whatever you want to say. whatever. But just keep the ego. The ego, its objections. Just say no. I'm not entertaining any of that. And the ego can brag and say, well, I know this, what you're saying is not true because I got an exception. I say, well, we'll see who brags last. You know, we'll see who laughs last, ego. The only trouble I have is a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. All these problems you're raising up to me, ego, they're meaningless. That's not the problem I have. The only problem I have is a continuity problem. I know truth is true. There are no exceptions to truth. It's just I have this continuity fear that I'm, you know, have to evaporate. So I'm not going to even entertain all these issues you bring up. There's no exception to truth whatsoever. All is perfect. No exception. So you practice this. I don't have a, you know, an exception problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. The exception problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. So defend your full stop in the wild by the continuity practice. Okay, this is how you can defend it. As the ego tries to throw exceptions at you, you say, ah, you know, no, I don't have an exception problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. This exception problem doesn't exist for me. Therefore, it has absolutely zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me, which means no exception whatsoever. Only the vision of no exception to truth has value for me. So we protect our full stop in the wild through the continuity practice, which is in the form of I don't have an exception problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The exception problem doesn't exist for me. Therefore, it has no value, zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And you can use that for whatever problem the ego brings up. You can name it if you want to. I don't have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a doubt problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The doubt problem does not exist for me. Therefore, it has no value whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So we haven't been emphasizing this continuity technique for quite some time because I spent so many videos on that, and hopefully it sank in. But now we're bringing it back to help us with this wow issue, this issue of the ego trying to bring up objections and exceptions, trying to get you to feel those and get into an argument about it. No, there are no exceptions to truth. So refuse to allow admit any of those exceptions or that the ego questions or whatever. No, I don't have a question problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The question problem doesn't exist for me. Therefore, it has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And so this is how you can keep yourself in the wow. Actually, doing this continuity exercise is how I actually shifted my perception to the vision of oneness several times. So I think we're bringing it all together right now, and I'm going to keep this continuity practice involved in the full stop in the wow phase. It's sort of in support of full stop in the wow. This is a practice in support of full stop in the wow. Refuse to entertain the ego, no matter what it tries to say, pull on you. Don't answer. It says, I don't have that problem. I only have a continuity problem. Meaning, I got a little bit of, you know, so much elation and some trepidation about the fact that there is no exception to truth that I'm, you know, a little nervous, a jittery about it, a little nervous. It's wow, I'm in the wow, I got this wow feeling. So I just get used to this wow feeling. Let it settle down and protect this by saying I don't have a exception problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The exception problem doesn't exist for me. Therefore, it has zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So now we've got it all going for us. The entire situation, we've got it going for us. And don't try to figure out how that's going to play out. Just keep the full stop in the wow. We'll find out for sure. So to have all blessings, we give all blessings to all without any exception. And then we explain to others how to get so that we can extend all blessings to all by this spiritual practice, by, you know, shutting out the ego, refusing to entertain the ego and all its, you know, antics and attempt to disrupt our familiarity and expectations, which are key. The ego knows this. The ego tries to disrupt and prevent us from settling in into a comfort zone. Our expectations and our familiarity tries to prevent that from happening, because it knows once we get familiar with this, you know, the ego's lies cannot bind us, hold us anymore, hold our attention anymore. No way. All right, it's getting a little chilly out here, for sure. So we have the whole enchilada, the entire situation now. Got it all, and probably just in time, right? And so we can go forward with confidence here. We're not lacking in the tools that we need. We can look at any wonderful truth, and we can manage that properly, manage our success properly now. So assertions, full stop in the wow, flipping the script, and then in support of full stop in the wow, the continuity assertion. You know, I do not have an exception problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. The exception problem doesn't even exist for me. Therefore, it has zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value. That's in support of the practice, especially the full stop in the wow. Wow. What is this? Some creature has just landed on the computer just very softly. Huh. Came in like a helicopter, so gently there. Interesting. Soft landing. So, soft landing, and soft landing of all our defenses, realizing that death is just a soft landing as everything else. Everything is equally a soft landing. Yes, I already know that all defenses have an equally soft landing. This is absolutely true. Yes, I already know that all defenses have an equally soft landing, and I don't want to catch a chill here. So, very great. I get to go inside now. All right, that's it for this one.